to your 6 pounds of urea. There's a few people that had questions. We're going to compost wood chip. We worked with Irving Company up in Canada, and per cubic yard of wood chip, you use 6 pounds of urea dissolved into about 15 gallons of water, and you spray it onto the wood chip. Don't go out there and scatter the granules into the wood chip because it won't do anything. Dissolve it in water, spray it on the foliage, on the piles of the wood chip, and then turn it, keep it wet, and you can compost wood chip in about 3 months. Down to where you can break them open, you may find some little white fibers on the inside, but they'll get brown, they'll get very hot, you can get temperatures of 160. You'll see them smoking sometimes, but it's not smoke, it's just steam. But the important thing is to keep them wet. If you don't keep them wet, they can burn. They will burn.
What was that ratio again?
6 pounds of urea per cubic yard of wood chip. Whatever it takes to wet the pile. Whatever it takes to wet the pile, water to do it. Mm-hmm. Any more questions?
What was the layer of compost you had on your pile?
In the wintertime, depending on the temperature, when we get down to zero, we made it about 12 inches thick. The rest of the time, about 6 inches thick.
That would be
finished compost on top. It makes a great insulating blanket. Compost makes a great filter because we filter the air with it too.
It doesn't hurt it to, if it dries out at all, it doesn't degrade the microorganisms or the structures.
Just put in 15 pounds of water that you need instead of
They do sell compost blankets. You cover the piles with. When we were composting crab waste here in Cambridge, and we used a blanket there, but it was more of a nuisance. There are actually turning machines that will roll the blanket and lay it back down again after it turned the pile, when they use windrow turners. But otherwise, we use this with biosolids. We just use a compost blanket, and then when you tore down the pile, that blanket became part of the compost. So therefore, we had multiple use out of it. Any more questions on composting?
Does manganese build up in wood ash?
No, you pretty well should go up the stack.
You mentioned that CO2 from fossil fuels has an isotope in it.
Isotope 13. Have you ever heard of carbon 14 they use for dating old stuff? Well, isotope 13 is one step down from carbon 14.
So any way we can scrub that to keep it from accumulating?
I'm not a physical chemist.
I'm just curious if anybody's worked on that.
I don't know. All I know is that I've read about the lab up in the Manaloa. They've been there since 1968 monitoring. They send up balloons way up high, pull them down, and measure the isotope level. And that's where the data is coming from with regards to accumulation of CO2 gases. And we know from research that was done that the CO2, because of that isotope, the CO2 cannot be absorbed by the tissues and made into photosynthesis.
Maybe we can GM plants to make that happen?
Pardon?
Maybe we can genetically modify plants to make that happen?
I'm not a cytogeneticist. I'm just a dumb horticulturist.
What role does pH play in composting?
Okay, I've composted cranberry waste from ocean spray. We had to add lime to compost it, and the compost ended out at a pH around 7-8. I've composted gelatin waste that had a pH of 13, and when we acidified it with sulfuric acid, it ended out at a pH of 8.2. Most compost, yard debris compost, will go about 6.8 to 7.2. Wood chip, it depends if it's coniferous, From that, you'll get down, you could compost it and be down to approximately a 4. Hardwoods will be 8.
So if you use it around blueberry plants, then do you have to be very
careful? I'll get into that.
All right.
Now, what do I know about blueberries? Well, before I came to Maryland, I managed a blueberry farm in New Hampshire, 500 acres. 2.5 acres of high bush blueberries, 500 acres of low bush blueberries. We produce 125 to 150 tons a year. Sold to the frozen food market in Boston. I have worked with the grower nurseries in the state of Maryland with azaleas and rhododendron. They're all members of the same family. They all have the same requirement. They are very sensitive to nitrates. Many years ago, Chesapeake Nursery down in Salisbury, Harrison Langler got a great deal on potassium nitrate, got a real buy. Went down and bought it and put it down on a field. Called me back 3 weeks later, Frankie said, we're in trouble. Can you help us? So I went down and the azaleas where they had treated it, had completely stopped growing. Completely stopped growing. And the foliage turned a dull green. And I said, what did you put down? He said, we put down potassium nitrate. I said, but azaleas can't use nitrate. Azaleas can only use ammonium. Why do we grow azaleas in acid soils? What does acid soils have that alkaline soils don't? What's the pH? What does pH mean?
Acid.
pH of 4 has got what?
Acid.
pH of 10 has got what? Alkaline. pH of 4, the definition is that the reciprocal of the hydrogen ion concentration, which means that it's a reciprocal. So that means the pH of 4 has more hydrogen ions than the pH of 8 or 10. Ammonium is found mostly accumulating in acid soils. Nitrates accumulate in alkaline soils, no, less acid soils. If you take and draw a pH of 7 is here, pH of 1 there, pH of 14 is there. You're going to find ammonium accumulate in this area and nitrate accumulate in this area. Now, what's interesting about plants is that, and this is some work I did with growing poinsettias. When the plant, a poinsettia plant is young, it can absorb both ammonium and nitrate. As a poinsettia matures and sets its flower bud, ammonia will damage it. It can only absorb nitrate. And therefore, that's how flowers, the fertilizers are blended for poinsettia production. What we did at Chesapeake Nursery, when I saw that, we did a study where we took a block, we applied ammonium sulfate, nitrate of soda, potassium nitrate, and urea. Within 3 weeks, plants receiving nitrate of soda, potassium nitrate, completely lost their color. And that block that he had treated the following spring didn't have one flower on it. The same thing happened to the blocks that we treated with nitrate of soda and potassium nitrate. The nitrate accumulated in the flower buds and the flower buds blasted. So therefore they didn't flower. Ammonium nitrate is really a combination. We saw good and bad results from it. But where we use ammonium sulfate and urea, we had no problem. This is very important when you're looking at these plants. Azaleas, rhododendron, blueberries, mountain laurel, andromedas all fall in the same category. They all have exactly the same requirement. There's an excellent textbook that I referred to many times, and especially in my work with compost. When the pH is below 5, when the organic matter content of soils are below 5%, pH plays a very important part in the availability of ammonium. As you raise the organic matter content to 8 and 10%, the humic acid and the fulvic acid that I found in compost and in high organic soils neutralize the effect of the higher pH on the absorption of the stabilization of ammonium in soils. Now, when I was growing blueberries, the owner of the farm was Dr. Bill Smith. We called him Blueberry Bill Smith. He was head of the Department of Horticulture at the University of New Hampshire. He was very interested in blueberries. He had to own the big farm he had. And he was always conducting studies, and I would be held responsible for putting down the material. And he became very interested in applying gypsum on blueberry fields. Why are blueberry soils acid? Well, firstly, they're very low in calcium in many cases. And by applying gypsum, we could see an increase in yield. Now, the difference between growing blueberries, the low bush blueberry versus the high bush blueberry, is that you prune the low bush blueberry by burning them. Every 3 years, we burn the fields. In 2 years, you harvest it for 2 years before you burn it again. In high bush, you do pruning. But what we found in all the studies that he conducted, and I used to have to take the data down, is that wherever we applied gypsum, combination of calcium and sulfur, we had increased yield. And I used to have photographs of the difference, so you could see a blue carpet before harvest versus a sparse blue fog in the background where we didn't. But as far as applying the nitrogen, yes, there's definitely a response to ammonium versus nitrates, and keep the nitrates out. I've seen this several times since we had the Chesapeake Nursery experience, and therefore I'm very convinced that we had to be very careful when we are treating the plants. There are a number of other things that we have to consider, and one is this manganese problem. We saw at Catoctin Mountain Orchard where the manganese literally wiped out high bush blueberries. And therefore, monitoring manganese, being careful what mulches you are using, because they're coming in on the hardwoods. Bob Black sent me some samples of aspen sawdust that had the high manganese content. How much of it you can get rid of in composting here and then using the compost there, I don't know. But we know that in composting hardwoods that we leave a lot of the manganese behind in the process of composting as the cells rupture. And therefore, we have less of a problem. You can increase the iron content up to a certain point where you can override the manganese. But I've seen too many cases now where even that doesn't work because there's so much manganese in the soil. But the combination of zinc, copper, and iron should always exceed the level of manganese found, and you're going to get that by soil testing. How many here have their soil tested? Shame on the rest of you. Because you cannot guess at this game. We need those soil test results to look at this imbalance that we see often. And I still do a lot of soil test recommendations for landscape contractors in the area. And the thing we're seeing now is a drop in sulfur content of soils. And therefore, we're having to add sulfur. But if you're using calcium sulfate, ammonium sulfate, you are adding sulfur, or iron sulfate, you are adding sulfur to the soil also. Well, we're reaching a point we're not adding enough and we're having to use powdered sulfur.
How are you adding it? What is the form? A granular?
If we're using sulfur, we use a wettable powder or the granular. Now, the interesting thing about sulfur, and this is, again, something I learned when I was working with compost. Compost is a great teacher. You know, experience is a great teacher. It gives the exams first and the lessons afterwards. Remember that. If you add sulfur powder, that is inert. Put sulfur in a glass of water and measure pH. You're going to measure neutral. It's inert. In order for sulfur to acidify, it has to be broken down by a thiobacillus. For oxidants. Thiobacillus for oxidants. That microorganism does not become active until the pH drops below 7. Doesn't become active until that organism, the pH drops below 7. So what do I have to do when someone sends me a soil test results and they get a pH of 8 and they want to grow blueberries? I take and I will add, look at my pH. I'll add anywhere from 10 to 20 pounds of iron sulfate. Now this will chemically lower the pH so that now, once the pH gets down below 7, the organism takes into action. And if you can lower the pH in that upper inch of soil, that's where the organism comes in and takes over.
Are those mycorrhiza, those organisms?
No. Thiobacillus is a bacteria. There are two bacteria, ferroxidans and, oh my God, never get old, you can start forgetting about these things. But there are two microorganisms that are responsible for the breaking down of sulfur. And both of them will not function until the pH gets down below 7. So what you have to do is chemically lower the pH. Whether you do it with sulfuric acid or you do it with iron sulfate, you will lower the pH and then in the upper inch of soil, and then the organism will kick in and the acid will now, because the organism converts the sulfur to sulfuric acid. That's what happens. Now, I didn't know that, and I was working with compost made from lime dewatered sludge. And I was attending a Sigma Xi meeting, and I was talking with an organic chemist. I said, I'm having a hell of a time lowering this pH with sulfur. He said, well, you damn fool, the organism won't start working until you get your pH down. So I started acidifying with sulfuric acid, and I'll be damned, it just took off like crazy. Live and learn, huh?
Do that on a large acreage?
Oh, yeah. I've done that in nurseries, azalea growers. But with azalea growers, I'll tell you what I like to do. I like to use pine fines.
Yeah.
Yeah, here's someone who knows pine fines. Do you know what pine fines are? Who knows what pine fines are? Raise your hand.
Don't tell me.
Yeah. Pine fines have a pH of 3.5 to 4. 3.5 to 4. So what you do is that you incorporate approximately 2 or 3 cubic yards per 1,000 square feet of pine vines along with the sulfur. Now you get an instant action going. And I've done this instead of using iron sulfate, especially when there's loads of iron in the ground. I use pine fines.
Where do you find it?
Well, there used to be a place, Forest Products, down here below Salisbury. Used to, I don't know if they're still in business or not.
Are they? Yeah.
Any wood processing plant?
Yeah, we used to get them in Parkersburg, West Virginia, down here in Salisbury area. Yeah, pine fines.
What are they exactly?
Well, when they make pine bark mulch, you've heard about pine, but they get the nuggets, then they get the coarser material, then they get the potting grade. The dust that comes out the bottom screen are pine fines. They're all lignin. There's no cellulose in them. And therefore, that means if you put them in the ground, they're not going to starve the soil of nitrogen. Huh? So therefore, it's a nice organic way of lowering the pH, of adding organic matter, and stimulating those microbes into action. I use it often. And I'm having to deal with some pHs. I'm working on a project now in D.C., outside of D.C. in Rockville. The soil has a pH of 12. And they want to grow plants in it. They planted $500,000 worth of trees and they're all dying. They didn't test the soil. Now I'm supposed to come in with my magic wand. Yeah. When I told them what they had to do, I'd about get kicked out of the room. That's all right. I said, I don't have to do this for a living. But this is an excellent way of agricultural-wise, and also pine fines are loaded with humic acid and fulvic acid. So therefore, they will add to the acidification process and make the microbes work even faster.
Pine needle mulch?
Pine needle mulch is for the birds. It looks nice, but there's nothing there.
How about cranberry mulch?
Well, cranberry mulch, what, are you getting it from the processing plant?
The neighbor.
Yeah. That has a pH of 3.2. Mm-hmm. When I worked with ocean spray cranberry waste after they squeezed the juice out and everything else, that's why we had to add hydrated lime to it to get the pH up to 6 so that we could compost it. And when I worked with Welsh's grape up in New York, same thing. The farmers wouldn't touch the stuff because they couldn't acidify the soil. So we added lime to it, we composted it. Now the farmers are waiting to take it home and compost it up there. Compost has done wonderful, doesn't it? Yeah? It hasn't cured the gout yet, but anyhow, when. But as far as blueberry nutrition, we have to be careful when all of these plants that are accustomed, are native to these acid soils. Because why are they growing there? Because no other plants can tolerate it, so they're growing there. Mother Nature planned this out very well. Can you imagine a mountain in New Hampshire covered with blueberries? Yeah, you could see it a mile away. You could see there were blueberries in that field because when they were ripe, there'd be a blue haze up there. And those are all granite soils, acid, and the blueberries thrived on it.
Some of the earliest stock was found in the wild that Coble used on the first blueberry.
That's right.
From there.
Yeah. Now, I'm playing with rabbit eye blueberries up here in Deal. Rabbit eyes and Corymbosum. And I'm doing very well with both of them. In fact, it's a good way to extend the harvesting season. The rabbit eyes, you have to control them a bit more in pruning, but whack away at them. People are afraid to prune. I went to one blueberry farm down in Salisbury. What was that down below?
Garden of Eden?
Yeah, yeah. I said, when the hell did you prune these damn things? Oh, we prune them. I said, yeah. So I started pruning on one of them. They told me to get out, you know. We used to prune the high bush blueberries in the wintertime where you could snap off the branches with leather gloves. Didn't use pruners very often. But anyhow, blueberries need good pruning to get size on the fruit and encourage that new growth. But they also want that ammonium fertilizer. They don't want those nitrates. They like that organic matter. But watch those manganese levels, because when you put them, get the wrong combination, you've got problems. Any more questions?
Are you going to touch on...
Now you see why I want to hire Chris Walsh?
Yeah.
It's sitting back there like a big old rooster, right? Yes.
Are you going to talk about charcoal at all?
No, why should I talk? I use it to cook outside with, but why use charcoal?
I add it to my compost and have wonderful results.
No, you haven't compared it. We don't want to use ash in compost. Never put ash, wood ash or anything like that in compost. It dries the pH up too high.
Real ash is charcoal.
But it's a waste of compost. It's a waste of charcoal. I have used activated carbon to absorb herbicides. I've been very successful. Allied Chemical, and I did it with the Casseron people, where they applied too much herbicide, we can absorb it with activated carbon. But to put charcoal in the compost pile, what are you doing?
I'll put it in the bottom of pots to help it get more aerated. And
you can put branches down there. They're a whole lot cheaper. Start your pile by putting branches and put it on top. Air can get underneath it.
I think I might be losing some manganese by burning it first.
You haven't tested it. I think it's a waste of charcoal. Any more questions?
Could you use quarry waste on your blueberries?
Pardon?
Could you use quarry waste on your blueberries for Grant?
Well, Grant is a very good source of potassium. One thing I've always noticed in looking at soil tests when I was running the blueberry farm, that we always had an excellent source of potassium, and because that was all granite soils up there, so therefore we never had to fertilize with potassium. The phosphorus levels were, at that time we had enough information on phosphorus so that phosphorus will actually inhibit mycorrhizal production. And I saw this work occur when I was working at a state forest nursery, but before they started putting compost in there, is that they had such high phosphorus levels, their roots had no mycorrhiza whatsoever, even though there was some organic matter. The minute we came in and added compost to it, the mycorrhiza on the roots would be like fibers, just hanging like spider webs. But where we had high phosphorus fertilizer, it was considerably less. And mycorrhiza are very efficient at extracting phosphorus from soils. And there's some good, strong data that supports that. And I've read it and reviewed it, that mycorrhiza, if you want mycorrhiza, keep those phosphorus levels down. And that makes a lot of sense.
Does that have anything to do with synthetic fertilizers and the potted plant nursery business and killing off mycorrhizae in the mix?
When I was working at a state forest nursery, that wasn't potted. That was all field-grown stock. That was all in-ground beds.
But doesn't 10-10-10 kill mycorrhizae?
No, it doesn't kill it. It suppresses it. Okay. But it's the phosphorus. Doesn't be 10-10-10. Okay. It could be 10-0-10. And you won't affect it. But it's the phosphorus present in the soil that inhibits mycorrhiza development, especially when it gets too high.
I've been told that mycorrhiza are the root system for blueberries, that they don't have root hairs. Is that incorrect?
If you have a mycorrhiza root system, you don't have root hairs. The mycorrhiza replaces the root hair. But you get three forms of mycorrhiza, ecto, endo, and ecto, endo. Ectendo.
I think it's the endo in the blueberry because
right.
They don't have root hairs.
Right, they don't have root hairs, right. And one interesting thing is that Dr. Smith was interested in breeding, and the seeds will germinate and die unless you have mycorrhiza soils in which you're germinating. They get to have the mycorrhiza right there as soon as the radical comes out of the seed. Otherwise, they won't make it. And that's why they have not been able to do tissue culture of it, because until they've learned to use that mycorrhiza. And it's quite specific from what I'm told. I'm not a botanist in that area.
Have you done any work with bioremediation, removing lead and arsenic from soils?
No, not with arsenic from soils. No, I have not done, most of our work was done with PCBs and dioxins. No, I haven't done any of that arsenic work, no. Be an interesting area of work. I'm leaving that to the younger people. Right now, no, the mind is willing, but the body is not, yeah.
Haven't they done some of that with hemp?
Pardon?
I think they've done some of that with hemp, haven't they? Pretty sure.
Hemp. I don't review papers like I used to.
To pull the out of the soil? Yeah.
Check it out.
If you are planting blueberries, should you plant more than one or two bushes?
Oh yeah, you want to have the multiple varieties so to get good cross-pollination, right? Okay. Yes. Yeah.
You've got a pile of wood chips that you're getting ready to put on your blueberries. What should you do?
You're going to compost it in one place. After it's composted and temperatures are dropped down and it's nice and brown, then you're going to put it on your, as a mulch.
If you put it on right away.
You're going to accumulate manganese underneath them. That's what you want to avoid. And also they're shallow rooted and you're going to starve them for nitrogen. Because they'll be sucking the nitrogen, the microbe, the mycelium will be sucking nitrogen out of the ground.
And just put nitrogen on the wood chips when they're around the plants, it does not?
No, it doesn't solve the problem because the nitrogen goes down, it doesn't stay. I had a student, an undergraduate student, that wanted to do a project one time. And we wanted to know, I said, let's grow marigolds in 10-inch pots and we're going to mulch them with shavings. And we're going to see how deep the mycelia penetrate. And mycelia went down 5 inches into the soil, and the marigolds where we applied the wood chip, hardly ever grew. The thing was just stealing the nitrogen out of the ground. Because although we had compost in the soil, it was stealing it. Where we didn't have the mulch, they grew like crazy. But we found mycelia down about 5 inches down the pot. And that was a 10-inch pot.
There's a whole thing going on with the Garden of Eden idea of adding wood chip online. It's very getting more popular, and it seems like that could be a big issue for accumulating manganese.
Give them time, and they'll find out. Okay. It's a very subtle problem. It doesn't occur instantly. The nitrogen occurs instantly, but not the manganese.
It starts with the blueberry plants not having enough nitrogen, even though you're putting on the recommended amount.
Yeah.
So the next thing you do is you double up the ammonium sulfate you're putting up there, and they start to grow out of the problem, then they throw some more damn wood chips on them, and you bump into the problem with the manganese.
And the more ammonium sulfate they put onto it, the faster the wood chips start to break down, and the faster the manganese starts to accumulate.
Do you have any insight to underneath the compost pile why it actually accumulates like right in the rhizosphere?
What is composting? Composting, the microbes break down the cells. Where are the nutrients? They're in the vacuoles and in the area inside the cell. So they are released. Now the nitrogen and phosphorus are in the bodies of these microorganisms. They're recirculating, and then they come out as a slow-release fertilizer once you put that compost down where you want it. But what your composting process is simply breaking down the cells and releasing the nutrients that are there. Now, what is interesting, there's a new material on the market called bloom. They're trying to sell it as a compost. It's not. It's coming out of Blue Plains Wastewater Treatment Plant. They've developed a process where after the sludge comes out of the digesters, it goes through a filter press to squeeze the water out of it. Then it goes into this chamber, which generates methane, which heats the chamber up to 190 to 200 degrees, and then they release the pressure that it develops in that chamber instantly. That's how Quaker Puff wheat and Quaker Puff rice is made, but not with sludge. And that causes the cells to rupture, and then the nutrients come out. But it's not composted. They're trying to sell it as compost, but it's not. I'm playing with it now. It's got a high, it's got a soluble salt level of 7 mmol/cm, but it has 60% organic matter. It has a high level of phosphorus, which I would expect from biosolids, low level of potassium, but up 2.5 to 3% nitrogen, which is more than what you'll find in compost. But it's a new process, and it can be done in 4 days compared to 40 days. And it comes out dry, and there's no odor to it at all.
We're doing that a lot with poultry waste now, yeah?
Well, I worked with dead chicken. We composted dead chicken, yeah. Yeah. 6 days, you get poached breasts. And 3 weeks, you get beaks and toenails. Yeah, we've done, also worked with the Park Service and doing roadkill up on Blue Ridge Parkway. And every time we used to teach the better composting school, we used to compost Bessie or Harry or Charlotte the pig and do a composting thing. Yeah. We learned, though, we always slip open the gut, fill the gut full, otherwise it can explode inside the pile. Yeah. Oh, fun. Composting has been a lot of fun. Any more questions? I don't know how we're doing on time. I think we get 5 more minutes.
I thought I heard you mention a textbook, but I didn't get the name of it.
Okay.
A textbook? You were saying there was it's a
On-Farm Composting Handbook. I don't know if there's still, I wrote about 3 chapters in it. We reviewed all the chapters in it, but it's one, it was with Cornell Press. And that has become the Bible for these commercial composters. I gave my last copy away to Veterans Composting. They're doing compost. They're going to be doing composting in Anne Arundel County with the horse manure and restaurant waste.
I have access to a lot of cranberry mulch, but the only limitation is putting it on by hand. Do you know of any mechanical?
Oh yeah.
Where you look for those?
Oh yeah. Was it Jasper? They had a spreader that instead of using paddles and a brush, it has a conveyor and has brushes, and it throws it out.
And Jasper is a big company. That
yeah, they made lawn equipment.
So road mulcher, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So sometimes put a layer of something on the blueberry to prevent frost. Damage to the root system.
No. Blueberries have an extremely hardy root system.
Not worry about that, huh?
No, blueberries have extremely hardy root system. I did work in root hardiness. In fact, this is back, I developed what they call a thermal blanket system for overwintering container grown nursery stock. And it was all based on work done on root system. Azalea roots, I took down to minus 14 degrees before I was able, and I still didn't kill them. Hollies, I took them down to 22 degrees and killed the roots. That's how I developed the thermal blanket system. I built, they didn't have them, they have them nowadays. I built what we call a death chamber. And that is, we dropped temperature 2 degrees per hour until we found the killing temperature. And blueberries have extremely hardy root system. So I wouldn't waste that for that purpose, right? And they're very shallow rooters, so they don't over mulch. One of the big problems with people that over mulch everything. You see these turtle mounds under the trees. These, wonder how many dead dogs and cats are buried underneath those things. Anybody else?
Mm-hmm. Where did you grow those apples?
Pardon?
Where did you grow those apples?
In New Hampshire. Yeah, the Triple Trouble Farm, 500 acres of blueberries. 35 acres apple orchard, 5 acre nursery.
The apples that you brought today?
No, those are not mine. Those are.
Nope, I grew them here.
Oh, very good.
Okay, I thank you all.